So we have already seen what are vector spaces. We have seen many examples of vector spaces. How do we study a set? How do we study a space? That's the first question anyone would like to ask. One of the best ways to study a space is to study the functions defined on that particular space. And what type of functions would be the next question. So the typical answer is all those functions which preserves the basic operations of the set will reveal a lot about that particular set. And in our case, a vector space has an addition operator and a scalar multiplication. So we would like to study those functions on vector spaces which preserve these. So I will start with a definition. Let me start with a definition. A function, okay, so before I say a function, let V and W, now there are two vector spaces in question, let V and W be two vector spaces over a field F. So we were always concentrating on F being either a real number or a complex number. So let V and W be two vector spaces over the field F. So we would like to study functions from V to W which have certain properties. Because as I said, they will help us study the vector spaces themselves better. So a function T from V to W is called a linear map if it satisfies the following properties. One, T of V1 plus V2 is T of V1 plus T of V2. And a second property that T of alpha, okay, alpha, AV is equal to A times T of V. So here whenever V1 and V2 belong to capital V, the vector space capital V, and this whenever V is in the vector space V and A belongs to F. So if you observe, what is happening is this operation is in the vector space capital V. This operation plus is in the vector space W. Here the scalar multiplication is happening in the vector space V. Here the scalar multiplication, which I will just put as a dot, is happening, or maybe I will not put a dot, is happening in the vector space W. So this is what I meant when I said it preserves the structure. So such a map will be always referring to as linear maps. Why they are important we will see in a few minutes, but before that, again, examples. So I will just note down the examples here. Let's see what would be the first best example. The first best example is the map T from V to W such that T of V is equal to 0 for all V. So this is basically a map which sends every vector in V to the 0 vector in W. It's very easy to check that this is linear, because T of V1, if you consider, maybe I will not write the explanation here, I will write it here. So if you consider, maybe I will rub it after I write it, I will just keep the important bits. T of V1 plus V2 is basically 0. And what is T of V1? This is also 0, which is the same as T of V2. Hence, t of v1 plus t of v2 is also 0. Therefore, t of v1 plus v2 is t of v1 plus t of v2. Satisfies this. Similar verification can be done. T of alpha v is also 0 because t is 0 on every vector. And hence, similarly, alpha times t of v is also 0. Why? Because t of v is 0. So, in particular, t of alpha v is alpha times t of v. So, this is probably the simplest example that one would be looking at of linear maps. Yes, and so let's look at slightly more difficult examples, or maybe not yet. The second best example which I would like to give is the map I from a map V, from a vector space V to itself, which is given by I of V is equal to V. Basically, this is the identity operator, identity linear map. Again, simple verification will reveal that it satisfies these properties. Yeah. Let's see what would be the next best example. So, one operator which I would like to, I will not use the word operator yet. One linear map which I would like to introduce right now, which will be more useful in the lectures to come, is the differential operator. So, define D from, so I don't know whether a notation was introduced, so let me call, C infinity was introduced, right? Yes. So, let me define from C infinity of R into C infinity of R. So, this is again going to be here. Consider defined by D of F to be equal to F prime. So, this, what is this? This is the derivative of F. F is a function from R to R. So, C infinity, what is C infinity of R? C infinity of R is the space of all F from R to R such that F is infinitely many times differentiable. Infinitely many times. So, in particular, we will just look at the first derivative. So, let me do one thing. Let me just put a 1 here. I will call it as D1. So, if you take a function F in C infinity of R, a derivative of C infinity of R function or a derivative of F will continue to be in C infinity of R. Infinitely differentiable function, when you take the derivative, it will continue to be infinitely differentiable. So, in particular, D prime is a map from C infinity of R into C infinity of R. In fact, we don't really have to, so I'll rub this part. So, subspaces are introduced, right? So, let's just look at a subspace. So, D prime can also be thought of as a map from P of R into P of R. Oh, okay. P of R. What is P of R? So, I will denote by P of R the set of all polynomials. This was just a space which was introduced. So, I will not go into the details of this space because it's already told to you. Look at the map P of look at the vector space P of R, and then you look at D prime of P to be P prime. Just take the derivative of the polynomial, right? It will continue to be a polynomial. So D prime is a linear map from P of R to P of R. Okay, so I have to check, or rather you have to check, that D prime is a linear map. Maybe I will just mention it. So, what is the requirement? We have to show that D prime is a linear map, right? In other words, it should satisfy these two properties. So, what was the addition operation on C infinity of R? The moment we talk about vector spaces, we will start worrying about the addition operation and the scalar multiplication, right? So what was the addition operation? It was point-wise addition, as was already told to you. So let us look at d prime of f and g, where f and g are point-wise addition. You should check. You would have seen this already. Basically, this is f plus g prime. It's very easy to check that this is f prime plus g prime. This will come from maybe first course in analysis. Similarly, you should check that d prime of alpha f is alpha times d prime of f. Or in other words, what it is saying is a constant times f, if you take the derivative, this is just the constant times the derivative. These are the basic things which you have already seen in analysis. We are trying to just put this in the language of vector spaces. So these are very familiar properties which is being presented to you in a slightly different language. So these two properties ensure that d prime is also a linear operator, a linear map. Okay, maybe because I am repeating the word linear operator, I will make this particular statement. We shall call a linear map from a vector space V to itself as a linear map, linear operator. So it's nothing fancy, it's just a jargon. If W is equal to V, we will call T a linear operator instead of a linear map. The reasons are lying in maybe functional analysis, which you don't really need to worry about at all. So every time there's a linear map from a vector space to itself, I'll just call it a linear operator. Okay? Okay, so basically, what I did just now is that I gave you two examples of linear operators. One is the identity map and another is the derivative map. Yeah, so maybe a third example. So I'll just rub this because you can, okay. The reason why I was mentioning this is because of another reason. Okay, the board is small. Should I rub this or should I rub that? Okay, so let me ask this. If you have a polynomial of degree m, and if you look at the derivative, what will be the degree of that polynomial? M minus 1. So here again introduced to you a space, polynomials of degree less than or equal to m. So what I will do is I'll give it a name. So that I can, let me call it as Pm of r. Okay? So I'll just denote by Pm of r all the polynomials of degree less than or equal to m. Yeah, they are all, so instead of v, I'm just giving it a fancy name because of classical reasons. The jargons are not very important, the space is important. If you understand the space, well and good. So what does it say? D prime, as you have already observed, D prime is a linear map from Pm of R into, where, let's see, you take any polynomial of degree m, what do you get after derivative? Sorry? Yes, m minus 1. So this will be m minus 1 of R. Right? So this is not a linear operator. This is a linear map from the vector space, which is the domain is not the same. This is m minus 1. So the domain is not the same as a range. I have already given a map which is not a linear operator. So this is a map which can be defined when V and W are different. V and W, any two vector spaces, we can define the zero linear map. However, you should observe that the identity operator can be defined only when V and W are the same. So this is another example of a linear map from polynomials of degree m to polynomials of degree m minus 1. Okay, so more examples. Oh yes, so the moment we speak about the first derivative, what is the big deal about first derivative? Why don't we look at second derivative? So question, what can we say? D2, let it be the second derivative. D2 of f is basically f double prime. Two derivatives. Again, from c infinity, so this is again, d2 is from c infinity of r, so let me write it, into c infinity of r. I can differentiate it any number of times. So you take any function f, you look at two derivatives. Now the question comes, is this operator linear? Now the first direction that one would think is, what would happen if we look at product of two functions and look at the derivative? Yes, there Leibniz rule etc. will come and there will be problem. However, we are not really interested in the product. We are only interested in the addition operation and the scalar operation. So you should check, which I will not do, that d2 of f plus g is actually d2 of f plus d2 of g. Similarly, d2 of alpha f is alpha times d of f. What are we actually trying to check here? Okay, I hope everybody has noted down the definition of a linear operator. Let me just stop this part. So what we are demanding is f plus g double prime should be f double prime plus g double prime, which you should check will be the case. Similarly, alpha times f double prime will be, yeah, so alpha times f double prime. This is again an analysis question which you should check. Okay? Right. So, there is again nothing special about 2. I could have done this for any positive integer k. So, my question, next question is, what about dk, where dk of f, so dk, let's define dk, to be a map from c infinity. If you are finding any discomfort with the space c infinity, no problem, just replace it by polynomials. So I have already given a name, p of r, polynomials to polynomials. We just have to understand the operator right now. Understanding c infinity and polynomials etc. is a job which we will do some other time. So dk as an operator is, yeah, linear operator. When I say operator, I mean a linear operator. Dk can be also thought of as a linear operator from pr to pr. What is dk? Dk of f is the kth derivative of f. We'll take the derivative k times. You should check that dk is also a linear operator. So I'll just do this. As a generalization or as a general remark, let me give a fourth example here, which is dk from c infinity. Again, as I said, if you are not happy with the space c infinity, no problem. Think of dk as polynomials to polynomials. Dk of f is the kth derivative of f. I hope people sitting at the back can see this. Right? This is okay, right? Okay, so we have seen sufficiently many examples. Did I miss any? There are some important examples which I would like to say. And maybe it's one more example which I would mention is, so all these, I am just using different notations. I, d prime, d, dk, all these are being used with those notations because they have classical reasons. You can think of all those as just operators which you can call t, doesn't matter. Okay, so don't be intimidated by the expression. These expressions are just there because of classical reasons. Okay. One more example, again, I am going to use another expression which I will denote by m subscript x. M subscript x I will define from polynomials to itself. where mx of p is just x times p of x. So what it does is take any polynomial a0 plus a1x plus an x to the power n. Suppose this is the polynomial p of x. Then mx of p of x is a0x plus a1x square plus an x to the power n plus 1. Again, I will not do this. You should check. It's an easy check that mx is a linear. I'm not going to use the word operator. Or a linear map from polynomials to itself. Oh, one more very important example which I should be introducing is, so already you have seen you have seen matrices. Okay. I didn't give the most basic example which I should have given in the first place. Maybe I will give it as a zero example. Let me write it as a zero example. This should have been, maybe 1'. I'm going to give it a name 1'. Maybe I should have given this example after the zero, or maybe after identity. No, let it be after zero. This is more important, I would say. Let A be an m cross n matrix over F, over R, or even C. And I write like this, it could be either over R or over complex numbers. Okay? Maybe I'll call it as F from now on. So when I say over R, over F, what it means is that F is either equal to R or C. Okay, it holds for both. So let A be an M cross N matrix over F. So you already saw what a basis is. So somebody tell me what is the first example of Rn? It was already introduced to you. I'm just trying to get your memory back. What is a standard basis of Rn? Yes, once in the ith place and zero elsewhere. So this is in the ith place, right? So he was always restricting to R2 for simplicity. I'll call it by EA. Let me always call such a standard basis by EI, where EI is one in the ith position and zero elsewhere. So in other words, what is the basis? E1 up to EN is a basis of RN which we shall call as the standard basis. Okay? So again, the next thing was, he also did this. So every vector V in Rn, we can write it as V is equal to V1 E1 plus up to Vn En. So I can think of V as an n tuple, right? So this is with respect to a basis. So the reason why most times we won't use such a tuple is because it depends on the basis that we pick. An example that was given to you was that if you have a vector like this and a vector like this, they will be linearly independent and they are of size 2. There are two vectors. In R2 they will form a basis. But then the expansion of V with respect to this basis will be different from the expansion of V with respect to E1 to EN. Okay? So this expansion as tuples depends very much on the basis that you pick. Okay, so this is say different basis. Let's call this basis F1 and F2. Then we might be okay. So let's stick to this. What I mean is, maybe I shouldn't waste my time here because it's already explained enough. But because I just started doing it, let me just do this. V is V1 comma V2 in R2. Okay, I'm now restricting my attention to R2. If you look at V as V1 E1 plus V2 E2, V1 V2 as a tuple is with respect to the basis E1 comma E2. But if you change the basis to F1 F2, V will turn out to be something like U is not a good notation. Let me call it A1 F1 plus A2 F2. So hence, if you write A1 A2 right now as a tuple here, it is with respect to F1 and F2. There's a good relationship between, there's a good methodology to go from this tuple to this tuple. We'll come to all that very later in the lecture if there is time. But what I'm trying to focus on right now is that when you write it as a tuple here, you should keep in mind the basis that is involved. The moment you change the basis, the tuple changes. So one for all, let me fix the fix a basis for Rn. Okay, so let us consider the standard basis of Rn. Okay? So now let us consider an m cross n matrix over R. So this could be done over Cn also. Always remember this. This could be done over Cn also. Now consider A to be this matrix A11, A1n, An1 up to Ann. Okay. What I'm trying to say is, so I'll write this I'll write this after this. So there is a 2 prime here, which I'll write here. A should be thought of as a map from Rn. Okay, so maybe I'll do it in slightly more generality. Instead of taking the same n, let me call this as M1 and this is Mn. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to define a map A from Rn to Rm. How am I going to define that map? So you take any vector V. So basically A is a map from Rn into Rm. So you take any vector V belonging to Rn. With respect to the standard basis, we have V is equal to say V1 up to Vn with respect to the standard basis. Yeah, I'll stop mentioning this with respect to standard basis from now on. Should always assume that it is with respect to the standard basis. So define AV to be equal to this matrix AM1 to AMN multiplied with V1 up to Vn. So I hope you are familiar with matrix multiplication? Yes. So let me just write this as just for the sake of completion, I'll just write what this will be. This will be A11 V1 plus A12 V2 plus up to A1n Vn dot 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 AM1 V1 plus up to AMn Vn. So observe that this is with respect to the standard basis in Rn and this is with respect to the standard basis in Rm. Okay, now it's an exercise. or a check. Check that A is a linear map. So basically, given any matrix of size m cross n, we can define like this a linear map from Rn to Rm. So yeah, as defined in the board. Okay, so one more important example of linear maps. Yes. Okay, so let's move on. I have seen enough examples. Yeah, I'm sorry, I have to rub it. Okay. Now the best thing about linear maps is you can consider, let S from V to W and T from V to W be linear maps. Okay. So I will define, let us define S plus T. So I am just giving it a notation as of now. As of now, S plus T doesn't mean anything. S plus T, however, I am going to define. How does it act on a vector V? So this dot, two dots and an equal to is meant to say that is defined by. So this, I am going to define it as S of V plus T of V. Okay. Okay, so as of now, before we defined this, S plus T did not have any meaning. But we now define it as S of V plus T of V. Check. It's a very easy check. S plus T, which is a map, linear map from V to W, is a linear map. So what am I doing? I am trying to define an operation on the linear maps from V to W. Just like how we have an operation on vector spaces, an addition operation. That's the reason why I could have just taken this plus and put it as a box. It doesn't matter. Right now it doesn't mean anything. So I could have just defined it like this also. The point is that this is going to be an operation. And the operation which is being defined like this, oh, one more thing which I'll have to define, so yeah, let me not confuse you people unnecessarily. Let me keep a plus sign here. And also define alpha s. Now as of now, a constant times an operator or a constant times a linear map doesn't make sense. But we are going to define it. How? It's defined as alpha acting on S of V. So this operation here is in W. So S is a map. S is a map from V to W. S of V will take a vector here and give us back a vector in W. Alpha will act on S of V in W. So you can define this is a definition. Okay. So this is again a scalar multiplication of an operator we have defined that. Now again check, alpha s is linear. So when I say alpha s is linear, what I mean is that alpha s is a linear map. Okay, so now we are in a position to mention one definition. Denote by L of VW to be all linear maps from V to W. Okay? So L of, so this is a theorem or maybe a lemma which will be proved if you do these checks. L of VW is a vector space over R. Okay, so I am not going to write R, I'll write F. Okay, so that, because let's leave the possibility that F could be a complex numbers also, the field of complex numbers as well. Okay, okay. That is one more thing done. Okay, let's see what to do next. Very important consequence of this, which you will actually have to look at in later lectures, is the following. So what does this tell us? This lemma is actually telling that if you consider all linear maps from V to W, it becomes a vector space, isn't it? Right? So in other words, if T from V to W and S from V to W are linear maps, alpha T plus, I'll not use the word alpha, A T plus B S is a linear map, again from V to W. So what we'll do is let's take some operators, So what is happening here? Let's look at these examples. There is a D1 which is from C infinity of R to C infinity of R. D2 is from C infinity of R to C infinity of R. Every DK, so DK from C infinity of R. So again, if you are unhappy with C infinity of R, restrict yourself to polynomials, no problem. For all K belongs to L of C infinity of R to C infinity of R, right, where L of VW, did I define what L of VW is? Okay, so there is a mistake, so definition, I defined, right, L of VW, okay, good. So, for observe that DK for each K is an element of L of C infinity of R to infinity of R. So for becoming more organized, I will call such a space as L of C infinity of R itself. Just once I will write it. Okay, what I mean is that if there is a L of V comma V will be written as L of V. Okay, I'll not write it twice. This notation, I'm just changing the notation a bit. When W is equal to V, that's all. Okay, so basically DK for all K belongs to L of C infinity of R, right? But L of C infinity of R has become a vector space. So we can consider linear combinations of such operators. So an example which will come many times in future in the lectures that Divakaran will be giving. I'll not take too many cases. Let's just look at this. A2 D2 plus A1 D1 plus A0 times I belongs to L of C infinity of R. Okay? What did I do? We are just looking at D2, D1 and the identity map. And we just took a linear combination. This is again a linear operator on C infinity of R. Now this operator is something which you should keep in mind. It will come again, it will be defined again, don't worry, because some of the beautiful applications that was being mentioned will be using some of these. Okay. Okay. Okay, so let me go ahead. So what can I rub? I can rub this. Okay. Next is defining a null space. So I don't know if you have seen it, but anyway, I'll define it again. Definition. So if you did not follow this at any point of time, don't worry. It will be revisited again. You will have an opportunity to look at it again. But let me tell you that if you are having any doubt, feel free to interrupt. The purpose of these talks is to understand as much as we can. Okay? Okay, so before we go into the definition, I would like to know if there are any doubts as of now. So till now we have seen what a linear operator is, linear map is. We have seen what a linear operator is. If the domain and the range are the same, we will call it a linear operator. We have seen some of the examples of what linear maps are. What else did we see? We also saw, we saw that the collection of linear maps from a vector space V to W, if you just take that collection, that will also be a vector space. An example would be like this. Right, so any doubts till now? Okay, so let's go ahead. Now, null space, I'll let V and W be vector finite dimensional. Okay, I'll restrict, no need for finite dimensional as of now. Vector spaces over F. Okay? Let V and W be vector spaces over F. And T from V to W be a linear map. We shall define the null space of T to be, and we will denote it by N of T. Okay? So T is a map, linear map from V to W. We are defining what a null space is. Null space of T is the set of all those vectors in V such that TV is 0. So I am going to use a term here right now. It is the collection of all vectors V which is killed by T. So whenever TV is equal to 0, we will think of it as killing that vector. So null space is all those vectors V such that TV is equal to 0. As was mentioned some time back in the previous lecture, we need many examples of vector spaces. Why is the study of vector spaces becoming so rich, so important? There are many vector spaces. There are many interesting vector spaces. And the thing is, many interesting vector spaces, okay, so before I mention that it comes out as null spaces, I would like to prove a proposition. Okay, examples. Before going into proposition, examples, they always matter. Let's see. Let's look at these examples. Somebody should tell me what's the null space of T, which is in the example 1. What will be the null space of T there? T is a, yes, why? So, the answer is V, the entire space V. Why? The null space of T is all those vectors such that TV is 0. But then that is what is happening to every vector in V. Hence null space of T is the entire space V. Now let's look at the identity map from, there is no prime. Let's look at the identity map from V to V. Yes. So basically what is the meaning of null space of I? It is the space of all those V such that IV is equal to 0, right? But what is IV? It's V itself, which is a set of all V, so that V is equal to 0, because IV is equal to V. So, null space of I is just the 0 set. Let's see. Okay, to make things slightly more simpler, let's look at D1 from polynomials over R. Maybe I will not write R, I will write F. This is true for complex numbers also, or rather this can be studied for complex numbers also. So D prime, or D1 is defined like this. D1 of a polynomial is the derivative of the polynomial. What is the null space here? So what are those polynomials which when you differentiate will be zero? Constants. So this is the set of all P in PR such that D1P is equal to zero. What is that? This is the set of all polynomials such that P prime is equal to zero, which will turn out to be the constants. Okay? So we will see more examples as and when needed. Okay. So another interesting thing would be to study the null space of linear combinations of these DKs. So I just mentioned an example of A2D2 plus A1D1 plus A0I. Null spaces of those operators can also be studied. They will turn out to be interesting. You will see that later. Okay. So what is one feature that we were observing when you are looking at the null spaces here? One feature was that null space of T here was the entire space V. V in particular is a vector subspace of itself. Okay. I, the null space is 0. 0 is a subspace. Similarly, you look at constants. Constants turn out to be a subspace. Should check all that. Okay. So this actually motivates a proposition. So I am going to define the definition. I am going to rub the definition here. I am going to give you a proposition. Yeah, maybe I can get the board fully. Okay. So proposition. N of T. So, the framework is, the framework has not changed. Maybe this is the last time I will write this. If there is no confusion, I will not write this line again. V to W, then N of T is a subspace of, N of T is a subset of which set? What was N of T? It was the set of all V in capital V such that T of T is 0. So, of V. Okay. So, let's quickly look at the proof. T. So, one simple check for something to be a subspace is, so enough to check that if V1 comma V2 belongs to N of T, then AV1 plus V2 belongs to N of T, isn't it? If this happens, N of T will be a subspace. That's how a subspace was defined. This was an equivalent condition which was framed in the first lecture that was given to you. Yeah, you should take this also, that this condition is equivalent. So let's take V1 and V2 belonging to N of T. So let's try and prove this. So what would be T of AV1 plus V2? So this is a linear map. So this will be ATV1 plus TV2. But V1 and V2 belongs to the null space. So what is TV1 and TV2? Yes, they are 0. Right? So this is basically 0 plus 0, which is 0. So AV1 plus V2 also belongs to the null space of T. This implies that N of T is a subspace. Okay. Yes, so as I was mentioning, this is one simple way of finding out subspaces of a given space. Given a vector space V, consider an operator T from V into some other space W. Look at the null space of T. They happen to be a subspace. So this is a method of generating subspaces. Our method is not to generate subspaces. Our method is to study those subspaces which are interesting and which occur as subspaces. And it turns out that there are many such subspaces which will turn out to be interesting. We will see that later. Okay. Okay. So, what is the next theorem that I should prove? So next, there is a proposition. Studying the null space of T reveals a lot about the operator itself. So now, next is a proposition. Let's look at a proposition. Okay. Let T, okay, I will not write this again. I'm saying this for the last time. Be vector space over F. Sorry. Yeah. Then T is injective if and only if the null space of T is 0. So T is injective means that T is 1 to 1. That means if T of V1 is equal to T of V2, then V1 is equal to V2. So T is injective if and only if the null space of T is 0. So let's quickly look at the proof. So it's an if and only if statement. So when I write IFF, it means if and only if. So suppose T is injective. Let's quickly go through the proof. The stress in these lectures are more on the concepts. The proofs are very important, but here understanding the concept is more important. So let's quickly just go through the proof. Suppose T is injective and V be an element of the null space of T. But V is an element of the null space of T means that T of V is 0. Okay, good. So now our question. Every vector space has a 0 element, right? There is a 0 belonging to every vector space. What is T of 0? 0. Always? Why? Why can't it be some other element of W? Let's see. It's very easy. 0 can be written as 0 plus 0. That's it. Now let's see. T of 0 is T of 0 plus 0. But T is a linear map. This is T of 0 plus T of 0. This T of 0 is 0. So this in particular tells us that 0 is T of 0. Okay. But then T is injective. So if T of V1 is equal to T of V2, V1 should be V2. So here V2 is 0. This implies V is equal to 0. Hence N of T is just the 0 set, because V, an element of N of T, was taken arbitrarily. You take any element, this forces V to be 0. Now let's prove the other way. Now let, what do we have? N of T is 0. Okay, now we'll prove this by prediction. Suppose V1 and V2 in capital V be such that T of V1 is equal to T of V2 in W. Now when I say in W, I just mean that the equality is happening in W. But then T is a linear map. This implies T of V1 plus T of minus V2 is 0. But T of V1 plus T of minus V2 is nothing but T of V1 plus minus V2, which is V1 minus V2. okay. But null, that means that V1 minus V2 belongs to the null space of 0, right? This implies V1 minus V2 belongs to N of T, okay. But null space of T is just the 0 element. That implies V1 minus V2 is 0, which is the same as saying that V1 is V2. Hence, T is injective. Okay, this proves the result. Okay. So, the proof gives us a completion to the proposition. Should remember the proposition very well though. Proofs can anytime be recalled, but the proposition should be, the statement should be something which should get embedded in your head. Okay, next is the concept of range of T. What's the time? Okay, I have a little more time. We'll take 10 more minutes. Okay, so let T be a linear map from V to W. We define the range of T to be R of T equal to the set of all W belonging to W. So, T is from V to W, remember that. So, in particular, this is a subset of W such that there exists V in capital V, in the vector space capital V, such that T of V is equal to W. Okay? So, R of T is the set of all the elements in W such that there is an element in the vector space V which gets mapped to W. A lemma or a proposition, you can call it either way, R of T is a subspace of W. I will not give a proof of this, but you should go back and sit down and check this. I will call this an exercise. Okay? Let's see, what next? So, given any vector space, there is a dimension to the given vector space, isn't it? It was the number of elements in a basis. And because any two bases will have the same number of elements, this is well defined. So, yeah. So I'll denote the dimension by dim. Okay, dim of V will represent the dimension of V. So, now I am going to give a very important theorem which will be called the fundamental theorem of linear maps, or some people call it the rank nullity theorem. Okay? So, let me mention this. So, a vector subspace in particular is also a vector space. We can speak about the dimension of vector subspaces also. Okay? So, let me, okay, so I will just rub this because the statement is important and this will be better for the board work. Theorem. Let T from V to W be a linear map and suppose V is finite dimensional. Okay. Then we can conclude two things. Range of T is finite dimensional. And the dimension of V is the sum of the dimension of the null space of T plus the dimension of the range of T. So, this is what I was saying. We get a lot more information about a vector space by studying operators on those vector spaces or functions on those vector spaces. What is happening here? A priori, we started with a vector space V, which was a vector space in itself. We take some linear operator and then look at the properties of that linear operator, which includes the null space of the operator, the range of the operator. And then what do we have? There are many times cases when studying the null space of some particular operator and the range of operator is easy, but studying V might not be easy in itself. In such cases, this gives us a method of finding the dimension of V based on the dimensions of the null space of T and the range space of T. So the T actually tells us a lot about V, it tells us the dimension. Right? There are more corollaries, we will look at it later, but we will look at a proof of this theorem because this is a very important theorem. Okay. So V is a finite dimensional vector space, right? Finite dimensional vector space. Okay. And null space of T is a subspace of V. And because V is finite dimensional, as Divakaran had already proved to you, a subspace will also be finite dimensional. So in particular, dimension of N of T will also be finite dimensional. Right? So let us say dimension of N of T is M. So what does that mean? There exists, hence there exists U1, U2, up to UM, which is a basis of N of T. That means U1, U2 up to UM spans N of T and they are linearly independent. Now towards the second half of, towards the end of the previous lecture, you saw that given any linearly independent set, it can be extended to a basis. So let us extend this particular set. Let us extend U1, U2 up to UM into a basis. To a basis. So I'm going to complete it. V1 up to VN. Okay? Basis of what? We are extending this to a basis of V. Right? Correct. So what is happening here? Now there are M UMs and N VNs. So what is the dimension of V? What is the dimension of V? Plus N. Okay? This is bad. Okay, I'm going to delete all these examples. So next I'm going to show that R of T is finite dimensional. That's one of the claims here. R of T is finite dimensional. So what do we see when we take a W in R of T? R of T is basically the range space of T. What does this mean? This means that there exists V in capital V, the vector space, such that T of V is equal to W. Correct? That's the definition of range space, R of T. But then U1, U2, UM, V1, V2 up to VM is a basis of V. So in particular, W is A1, V1 plus AM, not V1, let me call it U1, let me first use UM, plus B1, V1 plus up to BN, PN. Can write this uniquely. Right, V is equal, sorry. Correct? because V is an element of V and this is a basis, we can say this. So now let's apply T to this element. What is T of V? By linearity, this will be A1 times TU1 plus up to AM times TUM plus B1 times TV1 up to BN times TVN. But then U1 up to UM belongs to the null space. So TU1 up to TUM will be 0. So what will remain? This will be B1 times TV1 plus up to BN times TVN. Correct? So what does that mean? This is W. That's how V was picked. T of V is W. But then this can be done for any W in capital W, any W in the vector space capital W. So you take any vector W in the vector space capital W, you can write it as a linear combination of TV1, TV2 up to TVN. Yeah, it will be in R of T. More specifically, it is in R of T. It's not just in capital W. It's important that it is in R of T. We are going to find a basis of R of T, in fact. That's the intention. So if you observe, TV1 up to TVN, in fact, it's not in capital W. It need not be surjective at all. My mistake. So let me repeat, W belonging to R of T can be always written as a linear combination of TV1 up to TVN. In other words, TV1 up to TVN, which are elements of R of T, spans R of T. Correct? But then Vadakaran had proved one result, which said that if there is a spanning set which is finite, then the dimension of that set should be finite. In the previous lecture, there was one result which you should recall. This implies dimension. Why I am not yet talking about this being a basis is because we have not seen whether this is linearly independent yet. This will turn out to be linearly independent. We will see that in a minute. But we can already conclude one part of the theorem that we are trying to prove, that dimension of R of T is finite. So when I write less than infinity, I just mean that it is finite. Okay. So now there is a next target that we have. We want to show that dimension of V is dimension of the null space of T plus the dimension of the range space of T. But we have already checked that dimension, or rather by choice of our basis and all that, dimension of V is equal to N plus M. Correct? Go back a bit in your notes. This will be N plus M. But what was M? M is the dimension, by definition, dimension of N of T is equal to M. Okay, so if we show that the dimension of R of T is N, then the proof is complete. Correct? So we already have a candidate. Actually, we already have a set which spans R of T. If we show that TV1 up to TVN are linearly independent, then they turn out to be a basis of R of T, and hence the dimension of R of T would be N. Any doubts? No. Okay. So the only thing left to check is that TV1 up to TVN are linearly independent. So how do we do that? Look at a linear relation. We will show that there is no linear dependence. Suppose, I will not use B1 because it's already used. Let's see, C1 plus up to CN TVN is equal to 0. Suppose there is a linear relation. Suppose this is the case, then T, by linearity of the linear map T, this is the same as demanding that C1 V1 plus up to CN VN is 0. Correct? But what does this mean? C1 V1 plus C2 V2 up to CM VN is being killed by T. In other words, C1 V1 plus up to CN VN belongs to the null space of T. This implies C1 V1 plus C NVN belongs to N of T. But then N of T is having a basis already. What was the basis we picked? It was U1, U2 up to UM. And let's call this element as V as of now. Okay? V belongs to null space of T implies V is equal to D1 U1 plus up to DM UM. Correct? Why is this? V belongs to null space of T. Null space of T has a basis U1, U2 up to UM. Right? Right? Then what is V? V by choice was C1 V1 plus up to CN VN. Pulling it back, what do we have? D1 U1 plus up to DM UM plus minus of C1 V1 plus up to minus of CN VN is 0. But U1 to UM, comma V1 to VN is a basis of V. We started off by extending U1 to UM into a basis. So this was the basis. In other words, linear independence of U1 to UM, V1 to VN tells us that D1 to DM is 0, minus of C1 to minus of CN is 0. This implies DI is 0 and CI is 0. This is DI, this is CI. If you are not able to read it, that's what I have written. DI are 0, CI are 0. Why? Because this is a linear dependence. We are not interested in the DIs, we are interested in the CIs. So let me remind you how we started off with. We tried to see whether TV1 to TVN are linearly independent. Suppose there is a linear dependence, it will be something of this form. The moment we start off with something of this form, we are able to conclude that each of CI is 0. So what have we concluded? So here, suppose this implies by all these verifications that CI is equal to 0. Hence, T1 to TN are linearly independent. So that would tell us, okay, I'm jumping back and forth, which is bad. So this would tell us, so I'm going to rub this part because I'll keep, okay, that would tell us dimension of R of T is equal to N. And that is what we started off with. We wanted to prove that dimension of V is dimension of N of T plus dimension of R of T. Yeah, I will stop here because it's 1 o'clock. We will resume maybe after lunch. Okay? If there are any doubts, you can actually ask. There is still some more time to clear doubts. We will meet maybe, the time will be told to you in a minute. I'm not sure when we will meet again.